companions. We help you discover your many layers. You peel your car, you wake up, refresh eyes. Question life, question humanity, question society, but most of all, question yourself.
Interwoven Productions is all about connecting people to each other and their place through socially connected placemaking. They're very involved in their local communities, and in 2015, they launched Schoolometer, which uses the elements of circular and gift economy to be financially independent. We're happy to have Georgia with us on this episode of Onions Talk Changemakers.
So I'm Georgia Spinks, and I'm founder of Interwoven Productions, CIC. We've chatted, haven't we, over, I don't know, the last 12 months or maybe more, about various issues to do with creativity, about socially engaged creativity, and all around that. And I guess I would describe us as creative placemakers. So that's where I think we were probably coincide a little bit in our practice and our work. Creative placemaking is big in Canada. So if you have other friends in Canada, it's something that probably is more familiar there than it is in the UK. But we're certainly not the only people doing that. It means we work alongside communities, helping them find creative ways to celebrate their place. We're not the only people doing that. That's quite common, particularly in the States and in Canada. I think Australia, there's another really strong hotspot of that kind of work. I think where we probably are unique is that we've combined creative placemaking with circular economy. We set out really with quite a strong desire to be free of project funding, because I'm sure that this will speak to an awful lot of creators, is that as soon as project funding runs out, if you're doing socially engaged work, there's that horrible feeling you're just going to have to say goodbye to everyone. Sorry, it's all over. We're off. We've got to find funding for the next project. And that's not a good way to work on the streets with communities. That's a painful way to work. So we were quite keen that we didn't want to be projectified. We didn't want to have that imposed upon us by the funding. So we wanted to find a way that would be circular, ground up and grassroots, so that we could stay put and make a long-lasting commitment to any particular community.
So this is very interesting. But before we go more into the financial independence and how circular economy plays into part of the project, for people who don't know what creative placemaking is, who don't know about socially engaged arts, can you give some examples of the projects that you do with communities, what kind of work you engage with?
Yeah, absolutely. As I said, we started as socially engaged theatre makers. So the very first thing that we did was a partnership between myself and Alistair Ganley, who's a traditional theatre director. And I wrote a series of monologues. At the time, I developed an illness, which meant I couldn't stay employed. And I was essentially sort of ousted out of my paid work. Well, I was a bit cross about that. I was very cross. I was very angry, and I wrote a series of extremely angry monologues. And the whole thing was called Severance. And it was about what happens to you spiritually when someone decides you can't work. You're not fit for work. We don't want you. You're too much trouble. It's too hard. You've got to go. You're too old. You're too disabled. You're too... to this or to that, and we're going to take work from you. And that work is actually more than just an income. It's, you know, it's your contribution. So that's what that piece was about. And we were very keen to interview a whole range of people to come and share their experience of that and weave that into the performance. But it was still performed in a theatre, in a series of theatres, which had gotten a small tour just in the southwest of England. But it hit a lot of chords, and it made me very sure that engaged work was what I wanted to do. But what I was less sure about was whether I wanted to do it within those four walls of a theatre, because that seemed to be quite separating. So progressing on from there, our next stage was to think, well, if we took this out of doors, if we took it out of a theatre, and if we took it right into the heart of communities, first of all, we could connect with place. We could really be connected to landscapes. And by qualification and experience, I'm actually a landscape archaeology tutor. So that's where I came from before I sort of started writing and messing about with the arts. So the landscape and environment were always incredibly important to me. And while we were stuck in a theatre, we weren't connecting with that. We weren't connecting with, you know, the real world as far as I could see. And we weren't connecting with people in the same way. Because if you're in a theatre, you're always having to drag people into a building. Well, in this current crisis, of course, how right were we, I guess, to come out of theatres, to come out of doors, to go right into the heart and make connection with directly with communities. And the other thing that allowed us to do was make conversations, real conversations with people about what they thought was creativity. So now, to answer your question, now when we start a project, we haven't been near a theatre for a very long time. Now when we start a project, we don't even know what we're going to do. So we pull together what we call a pod, a street pod of local residents, steering group, and we sit and ask that question. And we spent the last 5 years learning how to get rid of that ego, that creative ego as an artist, and say, ditch that, that's got to go, and not to have any idea about what we're going to do. Because what we've learned, of course, is that communities have inherent culture. Every community of every sort, every community is multivocal, even if it looks as if it's completely not diverse at all. Every community is multivocal. So we learned a whole set of techniques to have conversations with multivocal communities so that we could ask them, what should this project look like? So whether it's worked out is that a project, an average project, is something like 9 months, and it will be based on place. So we'll spend a lot of time looking at particular aspects of place. So viewpoints. We've done stargazing, community stargazing, because there's just a lovely wide open sky. We've done a sacred trees tour, because one of our areas was just particularly rich in trees with wonderful folklore. Sometimes we'll just do a procession along a street, a long narrow suburban street that doesn't seem to have anything to say, but of course it does. If you just stop and listen, any street, any place has a story to tell. So it's just a question of stopping and listening to see what it will be. And as there'll be a series of mini events, and we'll invite schools and other local groups to get involved with us, but it will all be driven by the steering pod. And towards the end, they'll create an event, something that they can share with the wider community. So we've had pop-up exhibitions, photography exhibitions. It might be a performance. It might be a lantern parade, an intergenerational tea party, trail guides are particularly popular. They might want to design their own interpretation board to share a piece of their own hidden heritage. But what we've learned is that's their heritage, that's their place, that's how they want to present it. There is no, we don't have to come along and assess it for quality. All of those constructs that we sort of worked within before, when you're out there on the street, really have very little relevance whatsoever. So that's the kind of thing that we will do. We'll help them raise funds if they want to commission an artist to help them bring something say, an exhibition or something that they're creating in place, and it needs a professional artist to help them. We'll help them do that commissioning, but the commissioning will come from them. That's an awfully long reply.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
No, I've got more questions right now. So how do you engage with the community that you work with? Do you go out on the streets? Do you reach out to people? Or is it that you already have connections in the community? Because a lot of times we do socially engaged arts projects and we tend to reach out to our circle. But then the people who are most isolated or feel the most lonely in society are the ones whom you don't see going to community centres. So what kind of ways do you go about it?
Yeah, but that's where the place-based nature of what we do, and that's where I've taken a little bit of my archaeology background into what I'm doing right now, in the concept of a squillimeter. So it's an entirely made-up word. But essentially that's the basis of the technique that we've developed for this kind of community animation. And what it means is an archaeologist will put down a square meter grid, and they'll just use that to delineate an almost arbitrary patch of ground so that then they can really focus their research in that one place geographically. And that's what we've done with the squillimeter. It's a square kilometre, so we almost arbitrarily throw a grid down. And that means that you're capturing all the essence of place. And all of the essence of place is within that square kilometre. So the landscape, the topography, the viewpoints, the green spaces, the waste spaces, the built-up areas, the people. So you capture within your catchment a square kilometre of wonderful wonderfulness, and every single squillimeter, I can guarantee you, is full of wonderful wonderfulness for creative potential. And then the important thing is that you go even more hyperlocal. So you do what an archaeologist would do, is you've got your catchment, and then you would look very carefully. So you'd go street by street by street around your squillimeter. So you can choose the first one yourself, or it might be voted for. And run a project there. But as you're running that tsunami event and inviting people in, you're inviting them to vote for the next street inside their catchment and pop something in the hat to make it happen. And that's the circularity. So the next project, you'll turn up at the next street and you'll say, these guys around the corner, they put £300 in the pot to kickstart your street project. Off we go. And then you help them add a little bit more with some fundraising and from the local authority. And that's enough to run that street project. And you don't have to rely on anything else. And then they go around and around and around inside their square kilometre, one street at a time. And if you do it hyper-local in that way, you can knock on every single door. And that's how you engage. You can issue an invitation to every single person who lives on that street and potentially every single person who lives within that square kilometre.
Interesting. So do you have a physical space, a physical location where you go like, okay, this is where all the meetings are at, or is it just out in the open space, open air on the streets, and then you go knock them on?
It's really important not to have a physical space because mentally we always go to them. And we're very asset-based, because it's the other part of how we can do this and why we're so light on our feet, is that it's cheap as chips, because we don't maintain premises, we don't maintain staff or lug equipment around, we don't do any of that. And if we need space, then when we've got our street pod together, we may meet in their homes, or they'll know of someone we can go at the back of their shop. We always find space. We always find space, but it comes from the community. It comes from the street that we're working on, and we go to them. So we never require that anyone comes to us in any form.
So this is very interesting. Can you give an example of how it started out? So I imagine you have a group of you, and then you just go out on the streets and you just start knocking on doors.
Well, the thing is, when you start off your very first squillimeter, essentially, yes. Actually, it normally starts with an online presence. So each of our square metres, so we have 4 square metres in the city of Exeter now. We think the first one just outside of Exeter is coming online, fingers crossed for next week for the funding. We're also talking to an organisation in Scotland for the first one outside of England. So that would be very, very exciting. But when you start a school meter, when we started the very first one, it was just that. I mean, nobody had heard of a school meter. We just made it up. So of course nobody had heard of it. But I'd spent 12 months really thinking very hard about how it would be. So we were able to present it as if it was a thing. I chose my own street and my own community. I thought, well, that makes it easier. I'm only going to pop out there. I'm going to run up and down that road. And it's slightly risky because, you know, they know where I live. If they really don't like what I'm doing, they will tell me. But fortunately, it went really well. And we created, it was a scripted piece, and we found that that's probably not the way to go, but the first time we did. But it was very site sensitive, so it was based on the physical characteristics of that particular street. But then we introduced at the end of that, over 4 weeks, we had over 200 people walk with us, seeing their street again for the very first time. Realising that if you stand at one end and look at the far horizon, you can see an Iron Age hill fort and a series of Bronze Age burial mounds that people had never realised. And we were in a city. It's just because you could, if you knew what you were looking at, you could see it. So we took people on that sort of re-see your street adventure. And fortunately, they loved the idea of talking to us afterwards. And writing down on the card where we should go next inside the square meter, and popping something in the hat to let it happen. And once you've got that, once you've done the first one, off you go. We find now that more people in this particular city have heard of the square meter, that if you start off with via social networking, you can say to people, "Would you like a square meter in your place?" And now we've got, I think, about a dozen nominations for new school meters in Exeter because people want them. So it gets is a lot easier now than it was the very first time that 5 years ago when we first started parading up and down a suburban street in Bronze Age costume.
So if you can bring me through, every time that you knock on someone's door and you introduce the project, how would you introduce it?
Well, we put something in their letterbox. I mean, yeah. So when I say knock on the door, I think the first approach would probably be, this is happening. Would you like to know a little bit more? So, I always go by the power of three. Try to make sure that every individual, particularly on that street, if we're celebrating a street, receives an invitation in three different ways at three different times. And then I tend to think, well, if they've not responded to one of those, whether it's sometimes we'll stage something outside so to draw them to us rather than chasing them up the road. We'll certainly the first approach will go into letterboxes and certainly via social networking as well. Most communities have got their own community page and you can plug into that before we set up a school meter group. And then very quickly we set up a school meter group so that there is two-way conversation happening. It's really important to get that going quite quickly so that it's a conversation rather than a page which is a one-way broadcast, isn't it? Whereas a group allows people to come on and say, "Oh, I remember when," and "Oh, did you know on there?" And people love talking about their place. People love talking about their place.
So this brings me to my next point that I'm curious about. What do you think is the impact of this project for the community, but I guess also for you and the organisation?
See, I'd thought about it, what it is for the community, because obviously we are a community interest company, and we have our theory of change and our impact assessment program that we're so we think about impact all the time. So I can answer that, you know, readily. Connection is the impact that we aim to have, and we aim to prove that we have, reconnecting people to people and people to place. That's what we're all about. And if you have better connection, then you have improved mental and physical health. You have an improved environment, because people are connected to their place. They take care of their place. You have a reduction in social isolation, because if you know if there are a whole group of people on your street coming out to do something, you're going to come out and be part of that, potentially, even if it's just one small part. And you've got stronger and more cohesive communities. So greater connection between people to people and people to place brings a myriad, actually, of potential impacts. For individuals, we've got evidence that it builds confidence, that some of our street pods will have never have organised something like that before. And if you're just standing shoulder to shoulder with them and just running with their ideas, that's so much more confidence building than me rocking up and saying, "Oh, I've got a great idea. Let's do this." Increased skills. So we're embedding skills, heritage interpretation, particularly because of this archaeological bent that I can't help bringing to something. I look at a landscape and say, "Did you realise British landscapes are incredibly rich in prehistoric as well as historic context, and a greater sense of belonging. So individuals, we've got evidence that individuals are impacted in that way too. For me personally, I have to say that I have been the place champion for Heavertree. So since it started, where I live as a suburb of Exeter in Devon, and I am so connected to this place now. Everywhere I walk, it's like, that's where we all sang "All Things Bright and Beautiful" when we were being Victorian schoolchildren. And that's where we had dryads dancing around that tree. And that's where we did, we had that pop-up photography exhibition with the young people. And and I know people. Because even in a community that's, I mean, it's not that huge, but we're about 3,000-4,000 people. It's very easy to be invisible in a community of that size. So personally, it's been incredibly rewarding. I've never really stopped to think about that.
So would you say that people are a lot more connected now that you've done all these projects than before you started this project?
Yeah, I mean, yes. And we set out to demonstrate that, obviously, in our impact assessment. But do you know the thing about these impact assessments and evaluations? When you do this street-based work, it's really easy to tell when you're not doing it right. because they won't come. They just won't come. And it's really easy if they don't like it, because, you know, I live here, and they'll just come up and tell me. So the impact assessments, that formal evaluation process that we do go through, that's for funders. I think the relationship that I've got with my community, where they trust me just to tell me if it's not right, that to me is so much more important. And, you know, if we can get to a point where that is the relationship that we have directly with our community, it's like, "Joe, what was that? What was that piece of rubbish? Don't do that again." If they're telling me that, then that's what's meaningful. It's actually quite easy to tell.
A little side note. So, I mean, I've written for funding applications and stuff, and I've talked a lot to people in this field, and I'm always frustrated because, okay, like evaluation reports, this is what people need when they want to give funding. But how do you communicate that, you know, the quality of the project is not, it's not based on numbers, it's based on a relationship that you build with someone within the community, with the community. And I've kind of forgot where my question was going, but I guess it's about this question of evaluation, what do you give to the funders versus how can you even put in, I don't know, numbers or on paper, the beautiful connection that you form with people.
Yeah, yeah, it's this obsession with quantification, isn't it? And I really do think we're progressing beyond that. I mean, the one fund that we have taken, because as I say, we're trying very hard to be free of grant funding altogether, but we have taken National Lottery Heritage funding. Because they agreed to fund exactly what we wanted to do, and that was to develop a training package to transfer this technique. We didn't want the money to run the street projects, because as soon as you start introducing money on the street, we'd lose that wonderful moment when you say to a pod, this has been paid to you by these guys just around the corner, and this belongs to your community. Let's see if we can build on it and pass it on at the end. That's a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful thing. If you start pouring money on top of that, all of that wonderful voluntary effort, participation and ownership disappears. So we don't want to take grant funding, apart from the small pot funding that we do encourage our communities to apply for rather than us. But we don't, as an organisation, want to take grant funding to run the individual street projects. But we did need it to just for some time to develop the training package to allow this technique to transfer to other places. And to give them their due, they did allow that funding to happen. And normally you've got to say you're doing a particular project with specific outcomes. Well, how hard is that? Because we made a decision we were not going to decide for the communities before we turned up what it was going to be, let alone what the outcomes were going to be. And so what are we going to do? Go back on that. We're going to sit down with them at the table and say, well, actually, we've changed our mind. The funders said we've got to do this, this, and this by this date. And these are the people that we've got to work with, and that's the outcome. There's a whole bunch of people who have sat around the table who don't fall into that, because communities, believe it or not, are made up of old people and young people and middle people and all sorts of people. They're not segmented into social types and crazy. It's a crazy world, but I think it is changing.
Can you bring me through how it works financially? So how are the projects funded? And then you mentioned that you help them do fundraising if they want to bring in professional artists, or I imagine there'll be material cost. Are people willing to just fork money in for a project? How does it work exactly?
Okay. Well, it works on two levels. So when you're on an individual street project, it's very asset-based. So say we use the space that we find on the street, we don't pay for it. We use the materials that we find on the street, we don't pay for them. So we reuse. And we always say that if you need a sunset, well, go outside when the sun goes down. Nature provides that every single day. So that's the kind of ethos that we have, is that use, reuse, repurpose, and tread very lightly where you go. So that's one side of it. The other side is that there's this pay it forward. So they have kickstarting funding so that they know that if they do need to buy cakes for their first meetings or whatever, they've got something in the pot they can get going. And then we help them apply for small pots of local funding. So there's always community, local authority, small pots that are fairly easy to access. And they don't come with the same kind of strings as we as an organisation would have to battle with if we were trying to take a funding to run a whole project. And every street project is facilitated by a trained place champion for that particular square metre. And they act as a volunteer, and all of the other participants act. So we are a participatory network. We're part of what some people are calling a participation revolution. People get involved because they care about connection. They want to be part of that. They want to be part of a movement of connection. So I volunteer for that work on the street. When I'm on the street, I volunteer for Heavertree. So that's how a street project will work and how an individual square meter works. It's very low cost, it's very green, it's very asset based, and it's very circular. So it works. So we've been doing that for 5 years within square meters that works. But clearly that doesn't pay me a livelihood. So something had to happen, something had to give here. So that was where it was fantastic that we did get grant funding to spend some time developing a whole package of training for the place champions. Because these place champions are super participants. They're incredibly important. We can't state enough about how important it is to have someone who is trained and supported and loved in an interwoven way to go and do that participatory work in their community. So they don't get paid to do it, but they do get embraced into a support network so that they're peer supported with the other place champions, and they're trained with this designed package, a flexible package of a flexible learning that includes heritage interpretation, community animation, and everything that they need to know to facilitate the street pods, successive street pods in their school meter. And the idea is that these place champions are resident where they're working. They love and care for that community, but we scoop them up and into working family and support them through this training. So that so they get rewarded in that way. And then they also get the potential to become trainers of other place champions once they've done their 12-month training and run their first project successfully in a very supportive way. They'll be in a position then to transfer that knowledge. And at that point, it does become a paid role. So they will be paid to become a trainer of more place champions. So in order to, where does the money come from? That's going to be the question. Where's the money, Joe? Well, the money comes from, we charge for the training. So somebody has to pay for that training to happen. And for the first 12 months worth of street project to happen in a new school in Utah. And we're finding that local authorities are our main customer. Essentially, so they either find a grant or they procure it basically as a piece of training and they buy that training in. So we're just after 5 years of really proving the concept and embedding the technique, we're finding that we can sell that training now, and that's what plants a new square meter.
This is really interesting, because essentially what you're providing is a service, which is this training that is going to potentially in the long run create more jobs for these trainers who are trained to be able to train other people, which builds a new economy as well. But then it's not based on commercial products, it's not based on stuff, it's based on learning, it's based on facilitation, it's based on all these things that are soft skills that will help the community. This is really interesting. And also it cuts down the time and effort or energy that you would otherwise have had to take to apply for funding yourself. So it's basically like, okay, I'm going to give you this service, I'm going to do this training, and then, well, you authorities or whoever will have to find your own funding for it, which cuts a lot of work on your side, which is very interesting and something that I think a lot of people in this field can probably learn something from. Okay, so now this is my next question that I've been really curious about. So how has it been with COVID in the community?
Yeah, really interesting. It's been a time of, I've got survivor's guilt, fear. I feel a little bit wretched. It's almost like dust in my mouth. Because it's been incredibly beneficial to us. And that feels horrible to say, because I also personally know some people who've suffered badly. But it has been incredibly beneficial to us. If you think of the arts world and the comparison between what we do and those ongoing daily conversations directly with our community, and the fact that we don't maintain premises, we don't require anyone to come to us, that most of what we do out of doors, is perfect. We can completely carry on doing exactly what we've been doing. It's been seamless. And that's exactly what we've done. We've carried on and having daily conversations with all of our communities. We continue to train our pledge champions via Zoom. And they continue to have daily conversations. And if we need another meeting face-to-face, then we go out of doors. And we meet out of doors. And that's exactly, that would have been our modus operandi anyway, because we've always found when you start a street project, the sooner you get out of doors on the street, the better, because you're all about connecting people to place. It's been an extraordinary piece of vindication.
Did you have to do 2-3 meters social distancing while you're outdoors?
That's right, yeah. So you have distanced meetings.
Would you say that because of COVID and that everything was on pause, that people had more time to give for this project than before?
I don't know about that. I think here in Britain, it's hit us hard. Our residents, the people who would be forming our residents pod, they're still very nervous about coming out of doors and meeting face to face. So most of our daily conversations are via the Facebook groups, and via Zoom. So we're still not doing the kind of get together on the street that we would have done. It's hit us hard here in Britain. It's been tough. Not particularly for Interwoven, because we don't have overheads, and the other thing is there's been sort of a lot of things that we've been planning to do, like create an online portal where a lot of this learning and training and peer support can happen, that will take us away from some of the social networking, some of the existing social networks that I think it's fair to say can not always be the most positive environment. So we're all, and all of a sudden that funding seems to be opening up to us, so that we haven't got it yet. We haven't gone global yet, but there are funding route ways to bring forward plans that we had for that kind of thing. We didn't think we could even think about that for at least another 12 months. But now people are pushing us and saying, well, you know, now's the time, do it now. So it's been a really exciting time for Interwoven and for the School of Meter Technique. This time of vindication, though, that feels really, it feels like a kind of smug kind of word. And as I say, it does feel a little bit like dust in my mouth. It's hard to watch individuals go through some of the really tough times, and major theatres and arts venues are closing here. You know, now we hear all this daily of a big theatre closing down, and I'm not here to say that I'm delighted about that. That's going to have a big impact on our cultural climate. But the fact is, there were reasons that we decided 5 years ago that not to be in a theatre, not to be in a space. And how strange it is, this world that we're living in now.
But I think this is also a topic of resilience, right? We're talking about this uncertainty and this future that we're heading into, where a lot of things are changing. I mean, on top of that, there is climate change, which is this pressing urgency and us not doing enough. And then something like COVID hits, and what it's revealing is, what are the types of organizations or companies that are here to stay? What are the sort of interactions that people need? What are the sort of community support that will help people navigate through what's going to happen, especially in such times of uncertainty? And I think what your company offers is that, you know, it's not just about the trainings, it's about bringing people together, it's about connecting people. And when you have those community threads formed, they are there to stay and they form roots. And it's not just about your company, it's about the relationships between individuals within that community. And that sort of support, it plays out in a time like COVID, where, you know, you're suddenly forced into isolation, and I imagine that would be, there would have been a lot of community care going on, people supporting each other in terms of helping elderly buy food from supermarkets, or, you know, all sorts of connections that would have been so much easier to organize in your community, where there already is a community, than say, for example, in a big city where, you know, you have to go out printing papers and asking for people. I mean, those are great initiatives as well, but having that sort of resource, that sort of human connection that you can tap into immediately when something like this happens, and be able to give people the sort of emotional support that they need, because it's not just dependent on one person to give it, but that everyone is so interconnected, there is somebody to reach out to another. I think that's very revealing in this situation. And I don't think it's something that you should feel guilty about, because this is just what it is. And this is our future, whether we like it or not. We've got to be able to live with it and breathe it as well. And I think with theater, what's really interesting for me is, I mean, I've been through theater education and I had my good solid 3-4 years in London doing that. And it's beautiful to come together in a production, to work with people and to have something that is so emotional on stage, bring together the audiences. But what I found frustrating was always that, you know, there is so much power in that emotive force in theater and storytelling, but it always just ends after the performance. At most, you have a Q&A, and then that's it. What next? You know, you talk about, I don't know, something like Black Lives Matter. People have like Q&A, you know, you ask questions, maybe you tear a little bit, and then people forget about it the next day. So what is the impact? And I always felt like we have to push further with the arts. It's not the thing that people like about theater is also about being in a physical space, sharing those emotions and being in the same space as someone experiencing something. But it's got to be more than that, you know, like that is I feel like there is that innate need for us to want to connect with other human beings. That's why we want such a physical experience as that. But then I think we crave more as well, especially in sometimes quite alienating settings in cities where you're just working 9 to 5, and then weekends you're Netflixing, or, you know, you don't really have that sort of depth of human connection or community connection, which what you're doing with the company and communities that are also expanding is addressing this, which I feel is going to be the future of jobs. It's got to be more localized. It's got to be more about communities. But on top of all of that, my question is always, how can we encourage people to do more of this? What are the strategies? What are the ways? What are the models that can work? And it's so good to hear all this from you. I think I'm talking too much.
No, you're not. No. It's... Your enthusiasm is always so inspiring for you. That's why you've got such an international following. It's all inspiring.
Yeah. And so COVID, that's mentioned. And what are some of the things that you're hearing from your community over the past couple of months since COVID hit? I'm really curious about that, because I'm just in the middle of nowhere, moving around, and I'm seeing news, and I feel kind of detached as well. I wonder what the experience is for someone within a community that's quite tightly knitted.
Yeah, it's interesting. On our groups, people are enjoying not talking about it at all. So we're providing a little bit of escapism, actually. The imagery that I try to seed the groups with as well, and encourage our place champions with their respective school of meters, is to go out and take interesting and beautiful shots of their place, because we're allowed out for exercise walks, and to go out and do that, and to encourage their membership to do that too, and to share beautiful and inspiring imagery, because we're inundated with news about daily deaths and an awful lot of controversy over, you know, the way it's been managed, and that's it's exhausting. I mean, personally, I find it exhausting, and I've got off fairly lightly because I can work from home and I've got a garden, so I can actually be out of doors. Now that we're coming out of lockdown in a very sort of scary sort of nobody's really quite sure what the guidelines are anymore. People are quite scared, and so we're providing a space. What we're finding is most comforting right now is a space where it's a distraction. So we provide a space where people don't have to talk about it at all if they don't want to. At first, there was an awful lot of sharing of resources. We produced an online resource pack where people could, in families, they could research the history of their own home using techniques that are all online if they wanted to. And we shared that out. It sort of sits within our skill set. But we found that people were looking for excuses not to be at their computers and to actually spend some time away. So the sending them out to take an image of their place was a better way. And an image that wasn't about anything serious. Finding beautiful images in their place, reframing it, seeing it differently. So that's where we're at the moment. People are quite scared. They feel poorly informed about what the risk is now. They're being encouraged to come out of lockdown and they don't really know what to expect. That's the impression that I'm getting. So we're supporting people with information, but also with a place where they can come and talk about other things. It's nice to find it. And we keep our groups very safe. So we moderate them quite strictly. They don't get infiltrated with negativity. We just decided that it's not open forum. Sorry. It's not a place you can come on and rant about whatever you want and upset whoever you please. It's just not. It's a place for love and neighbourliness and connection. And we have two core values that we stick to. That's connectedness and equity of opportunity. And those are the values that we imprint our social networking with, our meetings with, our training with, and all the time we're constantly coming back to, if we do that way, is that going to cause disconnection? Is that going to be unfair and provide unequal opportunity? And it's our base point. We just keep coming back to those two things. And that's how we run our social networking as well. So some people don't like the fact that they might get thrown off or they might get closed down or we might remove some discussion. That's the decision we've made. It's not open forum. It's a place of love.
Can you elaborate more about the training and what are the aspects that you cover? Because, I've worked with vulnerability before and it's really difficult. Like, what are the boundaries? How do you make sure that it is a safe space? How do you ensure that everyone is okay? And, a lot of times when it bridges into psychology or mental illness, it's even trickier. Like, what kind of resources do you have in place in the training to make sure that your facilitators are well equipped to mediate that or to moderate that?
Yeah. So the first 5 or 6 units in the training cover this, and they cover how to organise and facilitate how to pull your street pod together in an equitable way. And then each of their practice, their pod meetings where they're facilitating their pod will be observed practice. So they will have someone, their trainer with them as they do that, so that at the end of the session, they get to run a reflection and action routine. So they both get to say, well, what worked well there? Why did that not work well? And they can also take that to the peer support group with the other place champions and say, well, I've encountered this. I've never seen this before. Have any of you guys? And then they can support each other in the same way. But basically, the main principles that run through those first 5 units are equity of opportunity. And we find that's about enabling the quiet voice. So there's an order to do your community animation in. And if you stop and listen to all of the first voices that you hear, you have to accept that you're hearing the animated voices already. So in any community, there are loud voices, you know, there are animated voices, there are voices who are confident, and they will be the first ones that you hear. And what most artists do when they outreach is they reach those and they say, oh, look, community, I've got community, and off they go. Whereas we recognise that actually that's not equitable, that's not equity of opportunity, because there will be other people that we've just not gone deeper for to animate the quiet voice. And so the first few units are about animating the quiet voice, finding them, finding those at least three separate different invitations to ensure that they have had every opportunity to hear the invitation to come join in, and thinking really carefully about how you present that and present it in at least three separate ways so that you can animate the quiet voice. And then you've got to keep working really hard with the quiet voice until you know you've heard them, till you know you've heard them, and then you can take their vision forward. And then it's really easy to re-engage with the louder voice, because there they are. Because there are always more confident people ready to contribute. And that will include groups, people who are already organised in groups, as well as individuals. So there's a process that we go through, and that's written into the training package. But it's also supported through observed practice and mentoring and peer support. Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. It reminds me of conversations that I've had with psychotherapists, and they also have their own network of support, where if they meet a particularly difficult case, they don't really know how to navigate, they usually go back to their peers or some sort of support network or community that they've already started building when they were in those training years.
Cool. Yeah, it's important that nobody's left. I mean, for safeguarding as well, it's really important that nobody's left doing that by themselves.
Yeah,
that's part of, you know, we've got a whole governance structure of safeguarding and health and safety and other things in place for each of these encounters, because it's important.
I think this is perhaps more a personal question, but I guess it also helps that as a facilitator, knowing that you don't know it all and giving space for that, it's important too. Because a lot of times you do the best that you can, but you're not well equipped or prepared for every single situation out there. And sometimes it's easy to berate ourselves over it, like, oh, I should have done this better. I should have known this better. But the fact is that we don't know, right? We just do the best that we can. And I think it's also allowing space for that and just, you know, take a deep breath and learn.
Yeah. Well, that's where the reflection and action routine comes in. That's where my background in education really helps me to frame some of this, is that I was always very, very keen on experiential learning, and have always put in place reflection and a time for reflection. And if you have a mentor, someone to do that with, that's even richer. So you can sit and think, oh, do you know, that did not go well. And believe me, that, you know, everything that we've learned, everything in that manual, is learned through that process, because we didn't get it right. We got lots of things right, but we didn't get everything right, and we learned a lot as we went along. So we reflected and we stopped and we thought, oh, you know, what's the learning inside that? And that's what the manual's made up of: examples, real examples, case studies, and reasons why, actually, if we try this, this might look like the most obvious way to go, but these are the reasons why that may not go so well.
So we're nearing the end of the hour. And what my final question is, if there is one thing that you can get someone to, your participant or, I don't know, someone out there, to do, if there is one thing that they can do to create change in this world, what would it be?
I would, well, in a very selfish way, I would say check out our website and find the participation framework, because there are 20 different ways detailed on that website about how you could take a part in this from wherever you are in the world. So check it out, and you can plan your own route way through the framework, your own entry point. You can combine opportunities. You can come all the way through to the board. You bring your passion. We'd love to talk to you. So on a very interwoven basis, that would be the one thing. Check out the interwoven website. I think it's under take a part, or I can't remember the exact tag, but you'll find the participation framework on the website.
The website?
Yes, which then the website is interwovenproductions.com. Apart from that, it's just love. It all comes down to love, doesn't it, Via? Just hold a bit of love.
Yeah.
If it comes from love and you're holding on to your values, it'll be okay. That's all I've got. That's all I've got.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Hello Onions Talk listeners, thank you so much for listening. If you liked what you heard, it would really help if you can leave a review on iTunes or like us on Facebook. Otherwise, subscribe and share it with people whom you think will enjoy this. Special thanks to Andrea for the music. Catch you next episode.